Space news. First exoplanet in another galaxy. Blue Origin news. Proxima C signal mystery. And more. Welcome to the 16th review of Space and Astronomy News, selected for you by the Insane Curiosity Channel. The news will try to provide a quick overview of everything interesting that has happened in recent days in the field of astronomical research and space exploration. Keep watching. First extrasolar planet found in another galaxy? All the extrasolar planets we know of are in our own galaxy, the Milky Way. But it's almost certain that they're also in other galaxies. There is no reason to assume otherwise. The problem, given the enormous distances involved, is being able to detect them. But now a promising system has been developed, and already a good candidate has emerged. Perhaps not the first ever, but the first single candidate, as well as the first for which there are sufficient clues to infer some physical characteristics. Before seeing how the authors of the discovery have managed to find it, here is a brief sketch of this extragalactic planet, by force of things still very hypothetical. Let's start with the bad news. The first we said is that for now it's only a candidate planet. It's not certain that it really exists. Indeed, we assume it only for lack of alternative explanations. The second is that if it exists, certainly it's not habitable, at least not by life forms as we understand it. About the size of Saturn and with a period of revolution of about 70 years, is in fact a world subjected to an intense and continuous bombardment of X-rays, such as to preclude the formation of an environment even vaguely hospitable, not to mention molecules such as DNA or RNA, the basis of life here on Earth. But just this fiercely hostile environment is what has allowed the team of astronomers led by Roseanne Di Stefano of the Center for Astrophysics at Harvard to discover it. Let's see how. The underlying technique is well known. They use the method of transits, or the detection of the decline in light produced by the passage of an exoplanet in front of its star. For a star shining in another galaxy, however, with a normal telescope, no matter how large, this would be impossible. For the extrasolar planets that we know, in fact, we speak of distances that barely reach 3,000 light years, while our extragalactic candidate resides in M51, a galaxy also known as the Whirlpool Galaxy, 28 million light years from us, too far away to be able to distinguish its stars from each other, let alone a planet from the star. If, however, instead of visible light, we look at X-ray radiation, things change. Since there are many fewer objects that emit X-rays, it is much easier for an X-ray-sensitive telescope to detect them, sometimes even feasible if they are in another galaxy. We're not talking about ordinary stars, but about sources that emit an intense flux of X-ray radiation, the so-called X-binaries, systems in which a very compact object, such as a neutron star or a black hole, is in the company of a companion star that orbits around it, gradually giving up part of its matter. Matter that, attracted by the intense gravitational field of a neutron star or black hole, falls at very high speed towards the compact object, heating up to reach millions of degrees and producing X-ray emission. Well, a planet that would periodically transit in front of an X-binary would eclipse the high-energy emission, astronomers calculate, causing a sharp drop in the X-band light curve, a decrease that can be appreciated even if observed from another galaxy, as is the case of the new planet. X-ray binaries can be ideal places to look for planets because, although they are a million times brighter than the Sun, the X-rays come from a very small region. In fact, the source studied here is smaller than Jupiter, so a transiting planet could completely block the light from the X-ray binary. And that's just the kind of signal, an X-band eclipse, identified by the study authors in the catalogs of the Space X-ray Telescopes Chandra of NASA and XMM Newton of ESA. The data collected by the two telescopes show that in the Whirlpool Galaxy, around the X-binary M51ULS1, the X emission periodically drops and then returns to its nominal value. A promising signal, but before even dreaming that it is really an extragalactic planet, it was necessary to exclude all possible alternative explanations. So it is by exclusion that Di Stefano and colleagues have proceeded. Could that eclipse be produced by the transit not of a planet but of another star? A brown dwarf or a red dwarf? Very unlikely for a young system like the one observed. Perhaps a cloud of gas and dust. The sharpness of the dimming curve and subsequent rise of the X light is not compatible with the transit of a cloud. Couldn't the dip then be explained by changes in the brightness of the source itself? The authors of the paper are quite certain that this is not the case because, although the light from the source completely disappeared for a few hours before returning, its temperature and color remained the same. Finally, they consider the hypothesis that, to cause the dimming, it may have been the companion star, the donor of matter, orbiting the compact object. In fact, XMM Newton has observed dips in light due to the donor star. There are also these, but they have a different duration and appearance than those attributed to the transit of the planet. In short, it seems that there, 28 million light years from us, around the X binary M51 ULS1, there really is a planet. And if a neutron star or a black hole seemed to us an object a bit unlikely to host the first of the extragalactic planets, we must remember that also the first extrasolar planet ever confirmed was discovered in 1992 right around a neutron star. Blue Origin wants to build a space station and put it into orbit within this decade. Jeff Bezos' own space company, Blue Origin, announced at the end of October its plan for a private space station called the Orbital Reef. It is said that the company will build the space station in collaboration with several companies, such as Sierra Space and Boeing, with the aim of putting it into orbit between 2025 and 2030. Blue Origin describes the Orbital Reef Station, which would inhabit up to 10 people, as a mixed-use business park in space that would have the ability to give exotic hospitality for space tourists. The company plans to use its New Glenn rocket to launch the Orbital Reef and will provide the space station's utility systems and core modules. According to a fact sheet released by Blue Origin, Orbital Reef will fly at an altitude of 500 kilometers, slightly above the International Space Station, with inhabitants experiencing 32 sunrises and sunsets a day. Crew and tourists will have a space of 830 cubic meters, only slightly smaller than that of the ISS, in futuristic modules with huge windows. Announced with the goal of opening multiple new markets in space, Orbital Reef is envisioned as a space where businesses, research entities, governments, and more can take advantage of the station's infrastructure and crew to create the premier commercial destination in low Earth orbit. To pull off this effort, Blue Origin is providing modules, utilities, and the use of its New Glenn launch system, while Sierra Space is providing more modules and the use of its Dream Chaser space plane, and Boeing is offering up its Starliner spacecraft, a science module, and maintenance resources for the station. Other partners bring their own expertise and resources to the party, including Genesis Engineering Solutions, which is developing a single-person spacecraft for use on the station as both an operational vehicle and kind of spacewalk craft for space tourists. For over 60 years, NASA and other space agencies have developed orbital space flight and space habitation, setting us up for commercial business to take off in this decade. Brent Sherwood, Senior Vice President of Advanced Development Programs for Blue Origin, said in a press release, "We will expand access, lower the cost, and provide all the services and amenities needed to normalize space flight. A vibrant business ecosystem will grow in low Earth orbit, generating new discoveries, new products, new entertainment, and global awareness. We very much hope so too. A privately run space station would mean further extraordinary acceleration for the 2.0 era of human space exploration. You agree too, don't you? Do you remember the signal coming from Proxima Centauri? Back in April of 2019, an Australian telescope picked up a very tantalizing radio signal that seemed to emanate from the sun's closest neighboring star. The signal didn't have any obvious explanation. Instead, it seemed to possess the hallmarks of something created by intelligent alien life. And in fact, that was the whole point of the research project that stumbled on the signal. Called Breakthrough Listen, the $100 million effort has spent the last 5 years using state-of-the-art telescopes around the world to listen in on signs of extraterrestrial life from around the galaxy. The 2019 signal, called BLC-1, Breakthrough Listen Candidate 1, was exactly what the breakthrough researchers were hoping to find. Detected by the Parkes Radio Telescope in southeastern Australia, BLC-1 was coming right from Proxima Centauri, a star just 4.2 light-years away and home to two planets, one of which is thought to be potentially habitable to life. According to Sophia Shake from the Berkeley SETI Research Center, the signal was uniquely similar to the kind of signal we would expect from space. It was something that could only be made by technology, and technology from space to boot. It lasted several hours, which ruled out satellites or aircraft. If it had a natural origin, the signal should have repeated over time, but the team never observed it again in dozens of hours of follow-up observations of Proxima Centauri. Instead, it was the type of one-and-done signal expected from an intelligent civilization. It seemed, therefore, an identification, if not sure, at least very interesting, but in the last 2 years, the breakthrough team has gone to review all the data, and the conclusion, motivated in two articles published in Nature, gave this response. Bad news, it's not aliens. There are no known electronics on Earth that intentionally transmit at BLC1's frequency, so one of the first places astronomers looked was space. They checked satellites, space probes, and even asteroids, which can reflect radio waves from Earth. When that search turned up dry, they looked at possible routes around the observatory for anything that could have theoretically produced the interference. Someone strolling around with a device in their pocket, a car on the freeway, a plane on the horizon. Any of these might have been able to mimic the drift of the signal. But when the team charted all the potential paths of a person or vehicle might have taken nearby, they found that none could explain BLC1. The team tried a new strategy. They searched for lookalikes. If BLC1 is not unique, if it was also detected when the telescope was pointing somewhere else, then it wasn't ET. Searching all the data they had taken on hundreds of other stars, the team turned up a few dozen signals that drifted exactly like BLC1, though around different frequencies. That's when I felt we had enough evidence to conclude that BLC1 was radio interference, Price recalls. With careful study, the team found that all of these signals could be produced by a single electronic device interfering with itself, producing weak radio waves at a range of frequencies that just barely leaked into the telescope. Price's best guess is some piece of high-end electronics tens or hundreds of miles away. What exactly the device was is beside the point. What matters is that the new tools Breakthrough Listen developed will be really useful when they find other interesting signals, explains Michael Garrett, University of Manchester, John Drell Bank Observatory, who wasn't involved in the study. We are really much more capable than we were a few years ago. If there is a signal out there, we're getting closer to being able to detect it. Since Breakthrough Listen has only searched about 1,000 stars out of their goal of 1,000,000, the project should have plenty of opportunities. Garrett is hopeful. One day we might discover something that would really change how we view ourselves and the universe. Ariane 5 flies without problems its heaviest load. Now it is ready for the James Webb Telescope. At 4:11 Universal Time on Sunday, October 24th, an Ariane 5 launcher was launched from French Guiana, carrying two communication satellites, SES-17 and Syracuse 4A, into orbit. This launch, with a total payload of 10,264 kilos, was the heaviest and bulkiest launch ever to geostationary orbit by Ariane Space. So bulky that to accommodate the two satellites, 1.5 meters in height, were added to the base of the fairing. With this flight, Ariane 5 has definitively dispelled any doubts about its performance, confirming that it is ready for the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope scheduled for December 18th. Performance on which there were some doubts since two launches in 2020 when vibrations were recorded higher than normal in the final part of the rocket known as the fairing or fairings. Although this problem did not affect in any way the launched loads, Ariane Space started an investigation to correct a defect that could be fatal for extremely delicate and very heavy missions like the upcoming James Webb one. Once the anomaly was detected, the component supplier, Swiss-based RUAG and ESA, made enormous efforts to fix the problem in time for the U.S. Space Telescope's launch. That's it, guys. We're done for the week. What do you think? What news struck you the most?